Hi everyone, I'm Steve Basil. Thanks for watching today. For today, I want to talk about something that's been kind of personally bothering me with some of the app integrations I've seen. And this is apps that are implementing their own file pickers on top of the Drive API. And first, what do I mean by a file picker? And this is really something that most of you should be familiar with. It's you know, an interface for selecting files from a file system, very much like what you would see if you were to say do a native file upload from your file system. People are building similar interfaces for selecting files from cloud services like Drive, as well as other services like Dropbox, Evernote, and so on. And the overwhelming reason for why I've heard of people wanting to do this really comes down to UX consistency. And you know, they basically want the interface to feel like it's part of the way their app looks and feels. And I'm gonna go into that in a little bit, in just a little bit more. But the other two reasons that this comes up, and these are a little bit more you know, technical reasons. One is you know, having to do with missing features with some of the alternative solutions, or for mobile applications where you know, a native file picker for that cloud service may or may not exist. And you know, I'll show you a couple screenshots. You can switch over to my screen here. I just want to show two quick ones. These are from apps that I've seen, just to give you a sense of what people are building. I'm not going to say which apps these are, but some of you may have seen these interfaces before. But here is one for picking from Drive, and another one here, which you know, very much shows what some of these issues are. So there's four reasons why the approaches that some of these developers have taken are problematic. Number one is pretty straightforward. It has to do with security. Since we launched the Drive API about a year ago, we have been pushing this notion of file-based permissions. So we have this drive.file.scope, which limits your application's access to only those files that the user chooses to share with your application. For this to work, though, it requires that we know which files the user chooses to share. And that's only possible if they do some action via our UI. And that happens automatically when they open a file from the Drive UI. It also works if you use our pre-built picker widget. And I'll show some demos of that in just a few minutes. And we think this is actually very important. In order to implement your own file picker, you need elevated permissions. At a minimum, you would need read-only access to the file metadata. If you actually need to read the contents of those files, you would also need you know, full read-write access to Drive, or actually at a minimum, just full read access to Drive. If you were to save files back, then you would need write access as well. But the point is that you need a lot of permissions in order to actually build something like this interface. And the more permissions you have, the more access you have to Drive, the more the user is exposed. You know, we certainly trust that you know, most developers out there take security seriously, but every time there's an application that has elevated access, that is one additional point of risk. And so we strongly encourage applications not to ask for more permissions than they need. And one of the best ways to do that is to use pre-built picker widgets like ours in order to minimize the level of access that you have. The second reason why these are these tend to be problematic, and you can actually see here in this particular screenshot that I showed, is a lot of developers don't design and test with large corpora. Most of the time, people will, you know, set up a test account and they'll put in, you know, a couple dozen files and folders and make sure that, you know, yeah, they can navigate and, you know, show files and show folders and navigate the hierarchy. But then you get somebody who is a Google Apps user, maybe they're part of a large organization, or they're, you know, really heavy Drive users like those of us here at Google, and these interfaces fall over. Personally, for example, you know, just for my Google.com account, you know, I certainly have, you know, thousands or even tens of thousands of files and folders, plus all the files that are shared with me, which, I mean, is, you know, just an incredibly large number of files. And there's been a few applications that I've tested out in the past few weeks where I would go and upload a file or try to upload a file and their picker interface would time out, would give me an error. In this particular case, they didn't anticipate somebody having more than 100 folders in their top-level directory. So, you know, it's you really have to, you know, plan ahead for not just, you know, simple test users or casual users, but really, you know, the business users, the people who are the power users, and heavily use Drive and have, you know, thousands, tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands of files within their database. The other area where the size of the corpus matters is on the response time for queries. For example, you know, our Google.com corpus is so large that, you know, some of the queries, you know, just the default page size that we use for the Drive API is too large. And just in my own testing, in order to reliably get results back quickly from the Drive API for a files.list call, really had to scale the page size down to about 50. And, you know, the default is somewhere around 1,000 or so. You know, and so you can see how, you know, once you're dealing with these large, you know, larger sets of files, especially if you have to, you know, really, you know, restrict yourself down to about 50 files per call, and that's a much more effective pattern for me. And so it's frustrating to go to an application where, you know, the file that I want to upload is not something that I created, it was something that was shared with me, and I haven't bothered to take the time to organize it into my own folder structure. And then, you know, I'm presented with an interface that makes it very difficult for me to get that content. And again, so, you know, so implementing alternatives such as search, or at least something complementary to a file picker, such as search, is really important. And lastly, I do want to touch on this issue of UX consistency. So, you know, again, the main reason why people have chosen to do their own pickers has really been because they want their this interface to look like the rest of their application. You know, and this is really a debatable point. And I think there's a strong argument to be made that for Drive users, it's equally as consistent to give them an interface that is the same as what they normally see on a day-to-day basis with Drive. And the file picker that we give to you as a third-party developer is actually the same picker that we use within our own properties. So it appears within Google Drive, within the editors. It appears in some of the other properties, such as Google Plus. And it, you know, so it's for Google users, people who are going to be using this particular functionality, it's an interface that they're already comfortable using with. And so you have to weigh that level of consistency and comfort against, you know, wanting to have that balanced with your own application. So that said, what are the preferred approaches? And really the simplest one is, if you're building a web application, is to use our picker widget. I'm going to switch over to just a quick little demo here, just to show some of the customizations that you can do. But this is our picker widget, assuming, okay, here we go, it's gonna load. I'm not doing this on a large, my corporate account, so this is actually a fairly small corpus, but trust me when I say that this actually works equally as fast, actually even faster on my Google.com account. It's pretty straightforward. We can actually do some customizations here. Say I wanna show, want to separate out my files versus things that are shared with me and allow upload. We actually have a nice little drag and drop, or we can do upload from our data file system that actually uploads into Drive and then shares that file out to your application. There's some really cool stuff you can do with the views. So I'm going to go here right now. You can see we have these controls. I can toggle over here and get a nice thumbnail view. Some of these actually don't have thumbnails, but, you know, we can kind of scroll down and we start to see those thumbnails load. It's a little slower than it should be today, but we can also pin that view into something. So if you just want to force it into, you know, thumbnail view, we can do that as well. We could also do things like filter by MIME type. Go back to list. And then anything that's not that MIME type will actually get filtered out. Of course, you can always, you know, navigate into folders, and that is good. Really straightforward. The cool thing with the picker, though, is it's not limited to just Google Docs, or Google Drive, rather. So if you want to allow people to pick from YouTube, from Google Image Search, there's a whole bunch of other properties that it actually integrates into YouTube. really powerful, and you can go over to developers.google.com/picker to learn more about that and how it works. But it's a really powerful interface. So that would be the preferred approach. There are a couple limitations, of course. The two are currently you cannot select folders as the target. So you can pick files from Drive, but there are cases where developers may need to select a folder. And so you can think of this as cases of, selecting the target for dropping files. So, you're doing online faxing or e-signatures and you want, the equivalent of a Dropbox folder so you can dump in incoming files. If you're a scanner, where to save things that they're scanned. And also as a location where you might want to be consuming files. So we see this with applications like Ift and a few others that do these file automations and they just watch a folder for changes. So there are cases where you're not interested in one particular file, but you just want to find a destination that you can then do something interesting with. In that case, the picker just doesn't work. That's more of a bug on our end and something that we hope to fix fairly soon. But the other case, which is a little bit harder to deal with, is mobile. And right now the picker is web only, that we don't have a native picker for any of the mobile platforms right now. And unfortunately, the web picker doesn't really respond well to being viewed on a mobile device. It's not quite designed to be responsive. And so if you're building a mobile application and you do need to select files or folders from Drive, you are pretty much left with building your own. There are some alternatives to our picker. One that I think is kind of cool is filepicker.io. And this is a really interesting product, a developer product. They basically built a layer on top of Drive and all the other cloud storage providers, Dropbox, Box, SkyDrive, Evernote, you name it. And they give you, a set of pre-built components. You can see here all their different services. And I can click and Drive and, just navigate through things just as well. And they have mobile pickers as well. They do have some of the same restrictions in terms of, I'm not entirely sure if they support folder selection. There are some issues if you are trying to do an app that supports both open with from Drive as well as using their picker. Within your app, they do mask the underlying file IDs. This is done for security reasons. That does make it a little bit difficult to implement both use cases, open from Drive and then pick a file from within your app, because you end up having to do the native Drive, our Drive API for that one use case and then their API for a separate use case. If your application doesn't need to be launched from within the Drive UI, FilePicker.io is actually a really nice solution. And it has the benefit that it gets you basically support for all of the cloud storage solutions within, with one integration. But again, it's not, it doesn't solve every use case, but it is something that, I would certainly encourage people to look for if that is the use case that they're trying to implement. Another option, and this kind of speaks more towards the folder case, which is, if you're trying to set a destination for where to put files, rather than giving the user the choice, just pick a default. And you actually see this a lot with applications like HelloFax and HelloSign, a few others that are using, just creating destination folders for their content. They don't even present a choice to the users. And the nice thing is, since Drive is based off of opaque IDs, so we have unique identifiers for files. It doesn't matter if the user then goes and renames that folder, or moves it, reorganizes it. Once you create that folder and you have that ID, the user can do whatever they want to it, and you'll still be able to do rights to that folder no matter where it goes. If they share it, they rename it, whatever. So easiest thing is just don't even bother with a picker. Just create what you need, and you're good to go. So for those cases where you don't really have a choice, you're building a mobile application, you need to be able to let users select from existing folders, and you can't create a new one just for your application. Just a few things to watch out for based on, some of the earlier problems. One is, certainly try to minimize the level of access that you need. If you are only reading the content, actually, better yet, we'll start with the most restrictive, which is, if you just need to pick a destination folder, you can actually pick a fairly narrow scope to build your picker. Basically what you would do is you can combine drive.file with drive.readonly.metadata. What that would do is you would have full read-write access to the files you create, but for the purposes of the picker, you would only have read access to the file metadata, which would be enough for you to, basically show the navigation structure for those folders, but you would not be able to read the contents, you would not be able to write to any of those files. And that would be a pretty reasonable way to narrow down the permissions for that case. If you do actually need to read the file that you just selected, then you would, instead of doing drive.readonly.metadata, you would use drive.readonly, which would then let you read that content. If you actually need to read and write, then you have to use the full drive scope. The other thing is, if you are building your own picker interface, consider adding a search option. This is really important for users that are parts of large organizations. They have far, far, far more files than your typical user. Many of those are files that are shared from coworkers and may not be proper, organized in a way that a file-oriented or folder-oriented navigation structure is really great for them. Adding a search option is really easy. Just add a text field. The API supports search. It's pretty easy to do that as an alternative. It's probably easier to do search than it is to actually build a file picker. And it's just way, way, way more useful for users to have that. I ran into a case recently of one of these other, not one that I showed, but an application that had their own Drive file picker, but they also had some YouTube integration. And the way they required users to say which YouTube video they wanted to attach was they had to go to YouTube, find the video, extract the video ID from the URL, and then copy that back into their field. And it's just horribly, horribly painful for users to do that when the YouTube API has a search capability that could have just as well have embedded YouTube search right in there and then extracted out the relevant information themselves. Please don't underappreciate the power that search has for these use cases. And lastly is just to make sure that you test with a large corpus. You don't have to have gigabytes of data. The actual file size is somewhat irrelevant, but when you do create your test accounts, make sure that you are creating a significant number of folders at the root level within as nested folders, and also to make sure that there are regular files in there as well to make just so that your page size the number of files that you need to fetch is some significant multiple of the page size. Set your page size to 50, and then make sure you have 1,000 or so folders in there. That way, you can see how your picker is responding when you have to make, 5 or 6 or 10 requests in order to populate the results. And I think once you do that, you're going to start to find out where these themes are, figure out ways to incrementally show those results, and just make that interface much, much more responsive for users that are heavy Drive users or parts of large organizations that have these tens or hundreds of thousands or even millions of files. For dealing with RESTful APIs, I would certainly strongly encourage everyone to use the Picker API. So that's it for today. Again, I hope this was useful and motivates people to do the right thing for their users. We'll be back next week. Not sure if we have a topic yet, but we'll let everyone know as soon as we can. Thanks.